wished to leave immediately after the funeral, but Georgiana entreated me to stay till she could get off to London, whither she was now at last invited by her uncle, Mr. Gibson, who had come down to direct his sister's interment and settle the family affairs. Georgiana said she dreaded being left alone with Eliza. From her she got neither sympathy in her dejection, support in her fears, nor aid in her preparations. So I bore with her feeble-minded wailings and selfish lamentations as well as I could, and did my best in sewing for her and packing her dresses. It is true that while I worked, she would idle, and I thought to myself, if you and I were destined to live always together, cousin, we would commence matters on a different footing. I should not settle tamely down into being the forbearing party. I should assign you your share of labor and compel you to accomplish it, or else it should be left undone. I should insist also on your keeping some of those drawlings, half insincere complaints hushed to your own breast. It is only because our connection happens to be very transitory, and coming at a particularly mournful season, that I consent thus to render it so patient and compliant on my part. At last I saw Georgiana off, but now it was Eliza's turn to request me to stay another week. Her plans required all her time and attention, she said. She was about to depart for some unknown bourne, and all day long she stayed in her own room, her own door bolted within, filling trunks, emptying drawers, burning papers, and holding no communication with anyone. She wished me to look after the house, to see callers and answer notes of condolence. One Monday morning, she told me I was at liberty, and, she added, I am obliged to you for your valuable services and discreet conduct. There is some difference between living with such a one as you and with Georgiana. You perform your own part in life and burden no one. Tomorrow, she continued, I set out for the continent. I shall take up my abode in a religious house near Lyle, a nunnery, you could call it. There I shall be quiet and unmolested. I shall devote myself for a time to the examination of the Roman Catholic dogmas and to a careful study of the workings of their system, if I find it to be, as I have suspected is, the one best calculated to ensure the doing of all things decently and in order. I shall embrace the tenets of Rome and probably take the veil. I neither expressed surprise at this resolution nor attempted to dissuade her from it. The vocation will fit you to a hair, I thought. May good may it do to you. When we parted, she said, goodbye, cousin Jane Eyre. I wish you well. You have some sense. I then returned. You are not without sense, cousin Eliza, but what you have, I suppose, in another year will be walled up alive in a French convent. However, it is not my business, and so it suits you. I don't much care. You are in the right, said she, and with these words we each went our separate way. As I shall not have occasion to refer either to her or her sister again, I may as well mention here that Georgiana made an advantageous match with a wealthy, worn-out man of fashion, and that Eliza actually took the veil and is at this day superior of the convent, where she passed the period of her novitiate, which she endowed with her fortune. How people feel when they are returning home from an absence, long or short, I did not know. I had never experienced the sensation. I had known what it was to come back to Gateshead when a child, after a long walk, to be scolded for looking cold or gloomy, and later what it was to come back from church to Lowood, to long for a plenteous meal and a good fire, and to be unable to get either. Neither of these returnings was very pleasant or desirable. No magnet drew me to a given point, increasing its strength of attraction the nearer I came. The return to Thornfield was yet to be tired. My journey seemed tedious, very tedious. 50 miles one day, a night spent at an inn, 50 miles the next day. During the first 12 hours, I thought of Mrs. Reed in her last moments. I saw her disfigured and discolored face, and heard her strangely altered voice. I mused on the funeral day, the coffin, the hearse, the black train of tenants and servants. Few was the number of relatives. The capping vault, the silent church, the solemn service. Then I thought of Eliza and Georgiana. I beheld one of the cynosure of a ballroom, the other the inmate of a convent cell, and I dwelt on the analyzed and analyzed their separate particularities of person and character. The evening arrival at the great town of scattered these thoughts. Night gave them quite another turn. Laying down on my traveler's bed, I left remnants for anticipation. I was going back to Thornfield, but how long was I to stay there? Not long, of that I was sure. I had heard from Mrs. Fairfax in the interim of my absence. The party at the Hall was dispersed. Mr. Rochester had left for London 3 weeks ago, but he was then expected to return in a fortnight. Mrs. Fairfax surmised that he was gone to make arrangements for his wedding, as he had talked of purchasing a new carriage. She said the idea of his marrying Miss Ingram still seemed strange to her, but from what everybody said and from what she had herself seen, she could no longer doubt that the event would surely take place. You would be strangely incredulous if you did doubt it, was my mental comment. I don't doubt it. The question followed, where was I to go? I dreamt of Miss Ingram all the night. In a vivid morning dream, I saw her closing the gates of Thornfield against me and pointing me out another road. And Mr. Rochester looked on with his arms folded, smiling, as it seemed, at both her and me. I had not notified to Mrs. Fairfax the exact day of my return, for I did not wish either car or carriage to meet me at Millcote. I proposed to walk the distance quietly by myself, and very quietly, after leaving my box in the Ulster Care, did I slip away from the George Inn about 6 o'clock of a June evening and take the old road to Thornfield, a road which lay chiefly through fields and was now little frequented. It was not a bright or splendid summer evening, though fair and soft. The haymakers were at work all along the road, and the sky, though far from cloudless, was such as promised well for the future. Its blue, where blue was visible, was mild and settled, and its cloud strata high and thin. The west, too, was warm, no watery gleam chilled it. It seemed as if there was a fire lit, an altar burning behind its scene of marbled vapor, and out of apertures shone a golden redness. I felt glad as the road shortened before me, so glad that I stopped once to ask myself what that joy meant, and to remain reason that it was not to my home I was going, or to a permanent resting place, or to a place where fond friends looked out for me and waited my arrival. Mrs. Fairfax will smile you a calm welcome, to be sure, said I, and little Adele will clap her hands and jump to see you. But you know very well you are thinking of another than they, and that he is not thinking of you. But what is so headstrong as youth? What so blind as inexperience? These affirmed that it was pleasure enough to have the privilege of again looking at Mr. Rochester, whether he looked on me or not. And they added, Haston, be with him while you may, but a few more days or weeks at most, and you are parted from him forever. And I then strangled a newborn agony, a deformed thing which I could not persuade myself to own and rear, and ran on. They are making hay, too, meadows, or rather the laborers are just quitting their work and returning home with their rakes on their shoulders. Now, at the hour I arrive, I have but a field or two to traverse, and then I shall cross the road and reach the gates. How full the hedges are of roses, but I have no time to gather any. I want to be at the house. I passed a tall brier shooting leafy and flowery. scarcely aware of my movements, and solidious only to appear calm, and above all, to control the working muscles of my face.